China is growing at an extreme pace, and their military is no exception. 20 years ago, China's military was virtually nothing, all extremely old and dated equipment left over from the Cold War. Now it's modernized into one of the most powerful in the world. With its spending only second to the US right now, and without all the costly upkeep on bases spread across the world like the US, they could focus on building up a pretty powerful force. And the one thing they are really focusing on is their aircraft carrier program. They already have their newest under construction, the Type 3. So I think it's worth asking, just how do they stack up against the famous US supercarriers of today? First, our sponsor, Manscaped. Manscaped has all your needs covered and perfected. No more cutting or nicking yourself with other products. We've all been there, or at least I know I have. It's not fun, it can hurt, even be traumatizing. But Manscaped works perfectly, and I can honestly say that I love this product. In fact, I already had my own before they even came to me to make this video, and they've clearly upgraded it since. They have everything you'll need in their all-in-one manscaping kit, making the process very quick and very easy. Their Lawnmower 3.0 comes with a built-in light and is water-resistant, so you can use it in the shower with no problems. And it has that most important feature called their advanced skin-safe technology. It sounds complicated, but it basically means you're not going to cut yourself. And speaking of cuts, Manscaped is cutting 20% off their regular price and giving you free shipping. Plus, for a limited time, you'll get two free gifts, the Shed Travel Bag and the Manscaped Anti-Chafing Boxer Briefs when you purchase the Perfect Package 3.0. But you need to use my code, COVERT20, at manscaped.com to get that. You won't regret it. China's carrier program happened extremely fast. They went from nothing 10 years ago, to modernizing an old Soviet carrier they bought, which they called the Type 1, to building their own, the Type 2, to now currently constructing the larger and much more capable Type 3, and even already planning their Type 4, a full supercarrier comparable to that of the US. The US, on the other hand, has been building supercarriers for years, with not many major changes since. Their newest, the Ford class, has some upgraded sensors and technology, but no major innovation over the Nimitz class. One big upgrade, though, is the electromagnetic launch system, which makes launching aircraft easier. Interestingly, though, China claims that their Type 3 will also use this. The US has really gotten the operation of an aircraft carrier down. It's not easy. You have a ship the size of a small town in terms of the crew and everything that goes with it. Food, supplies, sleeping arrangements, and that's just the basic needs. To operate it as a warship, you need everyone working perfectly in sync. The US has crews wear specific colors to keep track. Green, operating the catapult and landing equipment. Red, who handle weapons. Yellow, directing aircraft around on the deck, and on and on. It needs to be extremely well coordinated as you're dealing with $100 million aircraft on a multi-billion dollar ship, handling extremely flammable fuel and weapons, and all while you're out in the middle of the ocean moving at 15 or more knots. Also, possibly at night, and potentially all while under attack in the event of war. It's not easy, and that's why you hear of many accidents on board aircraft carriers. On top of this, you have the strategy and tactics of how to use a carrier effectively. How close should it get, where and when to deploy it, how to manage the aircraft you have on board, and even times it's in dry dock for maintenance, which could be over a year. The US has been doing this nonstop for over 100 years now, and it's figured it out pretty well. China, on the other hand, still has stuff to learn. You can build the technology, all the hardware, software, aircraft, weapons, but without that experience, it doesn't mean a whole lot. It's something that China is going to have to learn. But speaking of just the hardware, just the fun stuff that everyone likes to compare, the exact specs of China's Type 3 aren't known, but the Type 2 is, and since it's a step up, and likely larger, it'll likely hold some 40 to 50 aircraft. Now, that's not all fighter jets. You have other roles you need as well, like airborne early warning, anti-submarine, possibly some for cargo and personnel to move around, and maybe jamming and electronic warfare. This is currently where China lags behind. Right now, they don't have any fixed-wing AEW aircraft, like the US's E-2 Hawkeye. Instead, they use a helicopter for this role, which can't stay airborne as long, can't fly as high or as far, and carries a much less powerful radar. But you need this to see what's going on around you. The carrier itself, of course, has a search radar, but the horizon really limits how far you can see. You need something up in the air that can move around and help spot threats, and manage the battle. This is something China is working on, though. Several models have been shown of China's planned carrier-borne AEW, which looks similar to the US Hawkeye. Next would be electronic warfare aircraft. The US has one just for this purpose, the EA-18 Growler. These can be used to help jam enemy radar, making them virtually blind in a battle. China does supposedly have an EW variant of their J-15, but nothing we've seen designed from the ground up for this role. Tankers is another important role. The US got rid of the S-3 tanker variant, leaving only the F-A-18, which carry much smaller fuel pods, left. Tankers are important to be able to refuel in flight, allowing the fighter to stay airborne longer and in the fight. The US is currently working on developing an unmanned tanker, the MQ-25 Stingray. The drone is also stealthy, which helps as tankers are extremely vulnerable with no way to defend themselves, so having a stealthy tanker will help keep it safe by remaining hidden. A large tanker aircraft like the new KC-46 will often fly with fighter escorts to help defend it if necessary. So freeing up those escorts to use elsewhere is valuable, especially when you're talking about an aircraft carrier which is really limited in how many aircraft they can carry. And finally, the actual fighter jets themselves. The US is now operating a mix of FA-18 Hornets, Super Hornets, and now slowly introducing the F-35. China currently has the J-15, which was developed from the Russian Su-33. The aircraft has had several problems, and to add to that, Russia did not include the original engine when they sold the aircraft to China, meaning China had to build their own engine, which has had performance issues. It's also a pretty heavy aircraft, much heavier than the FA-18 or the F-35. That combined with the currently underpowered engine will make it difficult to compete with US aircraft in a fight. The current and near-term US advantage in stealth will further complicate things for China. Stealth does not mean invisible, but it'll make them much harder to see. Chinese fighters at long ranges might suddenly come under attack from seemingly nowhere. Their onboard radars likely won't pick up an F-35 50 or more kilometers away. It could end up being a pretty one-sided fight in favor of the US at this point. However, one advantage China does have is their IRST, or Infrared Search and Track System. If the conditions are right, and the sky is clear of clouds, it could help spot a stealth fighter at longer ranges, as the F-35 stealth doesn't help much in infrared. And China themselves are almost certainly working on their own stealth carrier-borne fighter jet. We could see a variant of the J-20 or even the J-31 operating off their carriers, but that is still likely a long way away. The next issue is the sheer number of fighter jets each one can carry. China's Type 3 will maybe carry around 25 or 30 fighters, where the US often operates 40 or 50, with the ability to carry more if needed. This is important, not just in terms of directly fighting each other, but also the time each is landing to rearm and refuel, time down for maintenance, or even completely out of service requiring repairs. And finally, for the ship themselves, neither China nor the US carriers carry any offensive weapons. China's Type 1, which was originally built as a Soviet Admiral Kuznetsov-class carrier, removed its ability to carry anti-ship missiles. Russia's carrier, which is of the same class, still has them, giving it a pretty dangerous capability against other ships. It currently carries 12 of the long-range supersonic P-700 anti-ship missiles, but neither the Type 1, Type 2, or planned Type 3 will carry these. Any anti-ship role will be the jobs of the aircraft themselves, same as the US. Now, this is all before they begin building and operate at Type 4. They still haven't finished the Type 3 yet, so it'll still be years away. But if it's built the way they claim, it will rival that of the US carriers, likely similar in size, in the number of aircraft carried, and type of aircraft. So things will change, and if they continue to grow at the same rate that they have been, it could go head-to-head with the US carriers soon. The limiting factor then would only be numbers. Right now, the US operates 11 supercarriers, where China has currently only two much smaller ones. But those 11 are spread across the world. 5 are currently based in the Pacific. And that, along with China's growing fleet of destroyers, frigates, and corvettes, some of which will escort its carriers, that advantage that the US currently holds is beginning to slip.